Thank you. The video starts with a question I'd like to put to you, Martin, as an economist and watching from London, within the British economy. Has the video, first of all, given us a fair picture of what is already happening? And on this basis, what do you think will happen next to the British economy?
Well, what's the line? Astrology exists to make economics look good. So I have always taken the view that I'm not a forecaster. And I think anyone who says that they know with any confidence what's going to happen to the UK economy over the next few years is essentially lying, because they don't. I think that the general expectation of forecasters, which is probably a little bit more meaningful, though not that meaningful, given that it's a one-off, it's a unique event. We haven't had this. There aren't experiments like this very often. Thank God, you might think. Is that there will be negative effects on output in the economy over the next several years, largely due to uncertainty, and the effects that is likely to have on investment, which we haven't seen so far. And the probability is that once we start the negotiating process and it will become obvious that there is a cliff edge likelihood at the end of it, that this uncertainty will become more serious and the investment slowdown will be considerable. And that would affect output. In the most recent last week, the Office for Budgetary Responsibility, which is, as it were, our official forecaster, an independent unit, thought that growth would slow, if I remember correctly, to 1.4% next year, then start to recover slowly with a cumulative loss of something over 3 years of somewhere at north of 2% points. It could easily be more than that. There's only one forecast who think the effect will be positive. So I think we're pretty clear it will be. I think it's overwhelmingly probable it will be negative over that period. To be clear, that does not imply a recession, because if growth continues as normal, we would probably expect growth. Now, that's itself very uncertain. The much bigger uncertainty is the future productivity growth of the UK, which has been unbelievably slow since 2007. So that's a bigger uncertainty by far than this one. But if it were to recover a little, this would merely mean that the growth rate slows. It doesn't actually give you a negative growth rate. The outcome on this will depend on the nature of the negotiations and what people start fearing as things go through it, particularly if they start thinking a year from now we have no idea what the environment is going to be. We're not there yet. This is my last comment. I could go on forever, but I won't. The main view of this question of the short-term impact, which you addressed here, and I think was reasonably well presented, is the thing we know least about, interestingly. I think we actually have a better idea of the longer-run impact. And there, the focus of the work on this, and which work produced by the IMF, the OECD, the British Treasury, other reputable forecasts, the National Institute for Economic Social Research, all basically concluded that as a result of Brexit, the British economy is likely to become more closed, less open to trade, less open to competition. This will have cumulative effects on productivity, which by the end of next decade will reduce the economy's size by anything between 3 percentage points and about 9, these are just orders of magnitude, relative to the base point. And so what would otherwise have happened? And what would otherwise have happened was probably growth of 1.5% on average or so. So you can do the arithmetic. So I think it's probably bad. We don't know how bad. And a lot of it will depend on what now is decided.
Thank you. And just returning to the immediate effect, it's a bit of a puzzle. If the prospect medium and long term is bad or worse, why is it that the immediate financial market effect has been not so bad?
Oh, the financial market, that doesn't mean anything. I should have perhaps, I don't pay any attention.
Exactly.
I don't pay any attention to stock markets. I just, they do whatever they do. No, the important point to understand, this is very important. The UK stock market includes overwhelmingly, particularly the FTSE 100, I can't remember which market they use, but the market of big stocks, includes overwhelmingly international companies. So a very high proportion of the profits in FTSE, I don't know exactly the proportion, but at least half represent foreign profits. It is less true for the other indices, but that's true of the main indices. Now, if the pound collapses, and we've obviously the biggest effect so far, I think that's obvious, so I didn't need to emphasize it, is a depreciation of the pound, then the value in sterling of these foreign profits increases very considerably. And so therefore you would expect the stock market, other things being equal, even if the British economy slows, as remember, most of the profits are being earned in other countries, in Europe, in America, all over the world, you'd expect the sterling value of those to rise substantially, and they have. So a better indicator, which is what I've done, is to look at the sterling, I did it in one of my columns, the sterling value, or the dollar value, it doesn't matter, the sterling value of the market in Britain as against other major markets, and it has in fact done relatively poorly. It's been rather a good period for the stock market quite broadly. So I don't think that tells you anything very interesting, because the British stock market is not an indicator of profitability in the British economy. This is very, very important.
Thank you. Monique, when you look at the British economy from the Netherlands, which of course is very close, and not just geographically, but historically and economically and financially, what concerns do you have about the impact on the Netherlands, the economic impact I'm thinking of now, of the kind of prospect that Martin has painted for the British economy?
I think what's important for the Dutch economy, the Dutch and the UK economy are very much interwoven, as you said, so that's clear. I think one of the main things that we're worried about is a long period of uncertainty. I think it's important to have some clear indications of what the UK wants, and then we can act on it. And I think this period of uncertainty is one of the things we worry about. What we feel is that we need a very orderly process, even though it's going to be difficult, but we need an orderly process in order to get the best out of this whole thing. This uncertainty is a big thing for us. There remain things, of course. We will deal with it. For us, the UK economy is important, but the economy of the rest of Europe is even more important, so we will stick with the rest of Europe. And what you can say about the European economy as a whole is that the internal market remains a key global player in the whole issue. And also without the UK, so it's not dependent on the UK if you talk about the whole of the European economy. And it will remain the largest economy after the US, if you look at it. Its GDP is more than 12,000 billion euros, or about 90% of the global economy. And we have a huge consumer market, of course, with 445 million consumers. So I think, yes, we're worried about the whole process. Yes, we have a very interlinked economy. All the things that Martin said are very true. We have to find a way out. And for us, the rest of Europe is even more important than the UK, so we will have to deal with it with the 27.
Thank you. And I just see that our final speaker. Our fourth and final speaker, Peter Altmaier, the head of the German Chancellery, has arrived. So thank you for joining us. We're just talking, and we've only just started to fill you in. We're speaking about the economics of Brexit at the moment, in particular. We are going to do that next, and I thought we might do a lot of that, so I thought we would ground things firmly, first of all, in the economic side before going on to the politics and the negotiation. So I'll let you catch your breath. ask you, Daniela. So you've heard the picture as it is from the UK and also from the Netherlands. How do you see the economic impacts of Brexit, in particular working on other EU member states?
Thanks very much, Stefan, and thanks for having me here tonight. Well, I think the big keyword is really uncertainty, and both previous speakers have alluded to that. Now, if I look at this from a continental European perspective, I would say Brexit is one uncertainty among many. And probably from at least a Eurozone perspective and a single market minus UK perspective, not the most important one. It is one key one, but if we look at the transatlantic relationship and how suddenly we are questioning whether we are actually maintaining a transatlantic marketplace, we might be undoing it, we might be somehow deepening it in the medium or long-term future. I think those are also variables that play into the question how Brexit will then affect continental Europe. For the figures, the Eurozone is still in a situation where growth is slow. There is growth, but it's below 2%. If projections are for next year are correct, this is definitely not adequate if we look at the catch-up process that some of the economies, which through the crisis fell back behind previous GDP levels, so they are still in a catch-up process, which is stalling in some regions and countries because of low investment, because of a lack of job creation, because of low domestic consumption. And so I would say for our perspectives to improve, certainty is a key issue, but also functioning financial markets. And it will also be important to assess whether in the medium term, the UK leaving the EU will actually be of benefit for those countries who remain if we know what economic and financial model the UK actually choose for themselves. Because that isn't clear at this point to me at least, but maybe Martin knows more about that. They're basically, let's put it that way, during the referendum campaign, there have been two competing models in out there among those who argued for Brexit. And one was a very liberal, very competitive idea of a kind of Singapore on the margins of the single market. And if this were implemented, and indeed productivity would rise, which Martin said is a problem, and capital inflows would increase into the UK, maybe some business would move there from continental Europe, but it might well also be the other way around. We simply don't know that yet, but I think if we look at a few indicators and a few statements from business leaders who are currently in the UK, there's a higher chance that investment will actually leave the UK than the other way around.
Thank you, Daniela, and thank you for at least mentioning that Brexit might have an upside. I was a bit worried that we don't have a Brexiteer on the panel, as far as I know, and we may not have too many in the room. But I think we at least need to question those possibilities. Peter, let me turn to you. How do you look at the economic aspects of Brexit? For Germany, Britain is an enormously important trading and business partner, but at the same time an economic policy partner in the EU. On the other hand, you also have the other 27 to think about. So how do you look at the economics of Brexit?
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much. First of all, good afternoon to everybody. Thank you to the Bertelsmann Foundation, Arthur Heuss, for organizing the event. And as far as the question is concerned, I can be very brief. I met 2 weeks ago with one of the leading people in the UK preparing for Brexit, and we had a very frank and open but also constructive exchange. And then he said, well, Peter, let's make a win-win situation out of this mess for everybody, for the EU, for the UK, for everybody. And then my answer was, well, I would wish that this would be possible, but when I look at the example of a long-standing married couple with three or four children, two cars, a house, and a weekend home, and when they then are going to divorce, it's quite difficult to imagine how they could make a win-win situation out of that mess for everybody. So it rather will look at a lose-lose situation. And this is something, of course, that we have to try to avoid to the possible extent. But when you have such a closely inter connected economy inside Europe, an enormous internal market with all the opportunities for trading goods and services, freedom of movement of people and capital. And then when you will take 10% of the people out of this, and more than 10% actually of the economic weight, then it is quite likely to create some implications, some negative implications. That means we have to be careful. We have an interest. We have an interest, as we have an interest in negotiating, for example, TTIP with the Americans and CETA with the Canadians. We have an interest in having as close economic ties and relationship with the United Kingdom as possible. But what we, and I'm not negotiating now. I have no mandate to negotiate. Not now, not next spring. It's negotiated by the Commission, by the Council, under the control of the Council. But it seems very clear to me that at the end of the day, when you leave the European Union, you can find arrangements to contain the damage, but at the end of the day, you will not be in a better position than before. Otherwise, it would mean that the existing member states like the Netherlands or Scandinavian countries or Eastern European countries would be in a worse situation than before. And this is why the Chancellor has explained in our parliament there will be no cherry picking exercises, but everybody is prepared for constructive arrangements and for constructive efforts to limit the damage that perhaps cannot be excluded to 100%.
Do you have particular concerns about any individual part of the German economy, for instance, the car industry, which has very large investments in Britain?
First of all, I have seen recent figures indicating that we have about 8 or 9 times as much export to the UK than the UK would export to Germany. Nevertheless, this is in the mutual interest of both of us, because if it would become more difficult for the car manufacturing industry to sell their products in the UK, probably our British friends would have to buy less sophisticated cars at higher prices. Yes, of course, there's a philosophy of free market economy. And I can remember in the 20s and in the 30s, there has been a campaign, not just in the United Kingdom, but in many European countries, in France, in Germany, in the United Kingdom, by British. And one of our great political poets, Kurt Tucholsky, has then published a poem about it, by British, by French, by Austrian, by Hungarian. And then he said, "Dear Germans, please buy German lemons." Yes, we have to strengthen our economies and not the Southern American and Italian economy. Yeah, so this is what describes it in a nutshell. And therefore, of course, we will look for arrangements. But it's not up to us to table the first proposals. It's up to the UK. And this is something where we have, by the way, backed the UK position after the referendum. We have said there is no pressure on when to trigger Article 51 or Article 50, and we have said, but the United Kingdom has to decide on the date for that, and then the United Kingdom will have to present its proposals on how to arrange our further relationship. I have heard a lot of articles, certainly also in the Financial Times, where it was said that the British British politicians are excluding the EEA model, they are excluding the Swiss model, they are excluding other models. I can understand it, but then of course at the end of the day we will have to decide what model seems to be appropriate to conserve as much of the internal market as we can.
Martin, if I now come back to you, the city, the financial services industry in Britain is very important. How hard do you think the government will fight to defend the interests of the city? And also, as an economist, can you say how difficult it would be for the British economy if a substantial part of city business did leave Britain?
I think I have to make my own position clear in two fundamental respects. They're really, really important respects. The first, which goes without saying, or at least it has been said, but I must make clear that I regard the decision to hold the referendum and the outcome of the referendum as quite simply the stupidest single decision made by Britain, unforced in the last century. And you'll have to think, therefore, about one of some of the things I'm including there. Okay? So it's just sensationally stupid. And it is interesting to be a citizen of a country which occasionally thought was moderately rational, that does things that you think are sensationally stupid. Fortunately for me, the Americans have caught up. Now, the second thing that I have to make absolutely clear is I really, not only that I'm not a representative of the British government, but I genuinely have no idea what they're thinking, if they're thinking at all. I have seen no evidence of it so far from anyone, from top to bottom. I am independent. I don't have one of the great good things about Britain is that one can continue to express exactly one's view. So I don't speak for the British government in the slightest way, and not least because I really don't know what they want. But this introduction is not unimportant. They are subject, and I do have great sympathy for the Prime Minister, who seems to me a moderately sensible human being, at least incomparably the least foolish in this strange circus we have at the moment, which is, I think she wants to preserve access to the single market, including notably for finance. She wishes to preserve access for manufacturing industry, which has already been mentioned. She would like to keep the economy moderately open. But she has also committed herself, and I think she feels personally very committed, to controls over immigration, whose details are utterly unknown, and whose content is utterly unknown, and whose economic implications could be very profound, but nonetheless they're going to be real. And she has also stated very convincingly, at least with great conviction, that she is determined not to remove Britain from control by influence of the European Court of Justice. Now, the people here are incomparably better informed and more intelligent than pretty well anyone in Britain, realizes that all these things cannot be combined. So the question you're asking essentially is, what is she going to sacrifice of these demands? Or what, more precisely, will she feel she has to sacrifice among these things? And here I'm just guessing. As an observer, you can make the same judge as I do. I feel I'm as much an outside observer. So in words, I feel that she thinks that she cannot get away without pretty credible controls on immigration, however stupid, and they are stupid. And And I think she feels she cannot get away with a situation in which the European Court of Justice, which means EU law, continues to play the same role as it did before. It follows, it seems to me, if you believe those two things, that whatever she wants, the city will no longer be inside the European single market. Finished. Okay? Passporting's gone and all the rest of it. And many other things follow. We can discuss, obviously, in more detail, what I think would follow. I'd be like to be corrected. Then you're asking yourself a really profound question is, if the city were outside the single market, what would be the impact on the city? And that depends essentially on two things, three things. One, the regulatory regime of the city itself, which would change in this situation somewhat. And some believe, could be improved in some respects, which I happen to agree with, because some of the European legislation and regulation in finance is not optimal. We could probably do a bit better. Not wildly better, but we could do a bit better. So that's the first question. What is our own regulatory regime? The second is, how will finance in the Europe, in the EU, be regulated and managed, particularly with respect to things like clearing and the role of the ECB in clearing after we have left, because I think that's what would happen. So how will it develop here? And the third, obviously, the sort of longer run question is how the city adapts, to, which is where I think we're going, to being an offshore financial center, which it has been in the past. My own guess, and it is no more than a guess, is the city would, in this circumstance, shrink perhaps by something like 20% in activity. It would remain far and away the largest financial center in Europe, but it would not dominate in the EU in the way it does. And that would be one of the prices we would pay for this decision. But the honest truth on those last numbers is they're essentially guesses based on the amount of clearance done in Europe, European, in the euro, and the likely effect. But I just make one final point, which is important to remember. I'm assuming throughout that the European Union will not adopt exchange controls. It will remain part of the global financial system. If it remains part of the global financial system, it will continue to be possible for European businesses, European individuals, to put their money anywhere in the world. And one of those places is going to be London. It clearly won't be the end of London. I mean, there's no doubt in my view, it will not be the end of London, but it will be a different London in quite important respects. It will go back essentially to being an offshore center in this time zone. And that change will be profound. And I don't think there's anything that I've heard which suggests to me that that won't be the outcome given the pressures on the government. I hope I'm wrong, but that's, I think, where it's going to end.
Peter, if that is what happens, and Martin, of course, has hedged his thoughts with caveats, but if London does move in that direction and does become an offshore centre, even the words offshore centre raise hackles in Berlin and not only in Berlin. If you saw that development, how worried would you be, for example, about tax competition from London? Ministers here have already expressed concerns about different kinds of tax competition from London. Would you be really worried about this?
I consider it rather challenging to comment on hypothetical consequences of hypothetical negotiations and their results. So we are not yet there. And certainly, we don't know whether there is life on Mars, but there is certainly life outside the EU. That is something I would always confirm as a genuine pro-European politician. Look at Iceland, look at Switzerland, look at other countries in Europe not being a member state of the European Union. And the United Kingdom has a long-standing tradition of 200 years of involvement in the process of globalization and world economy, and this is certainly something that will not disappear, not fully disappear. London will remain one of the most attractive capitals worldwide, and people from all countries in the world will buy flats and homes and in London. They will continue to do that. As far as the city is concerned and the financial market and the financial services, of course, we have now a competition in two directions. One is European countries are looking for disappointed inhabitants of the city and talking to them on the enormous chances for having at least part of their employees in in Europe, in France, in Germany, in Italy, in Luxembourg, in the Netherlands, elsewhere. And on the other side, the United Kingdom will try to be as competitive as possible and attract foreign investment also after the Brexit. The reduction of taxes is one of the means you can try to exploit. But reduction corporate taxes means you will perhaps have more investments but less tax revenues as well. And the question is whether this is the one and only aspect to be considered by foreign investors in Europe. I was enormously surprised when I was told by Apple, I believe it was Apple, that they are going to have their new European plant, where they have their cloud and all this kind of things, in Denmark, not in Germany. We were highly interested in that. And they have an enormous demand for electricity. And electricity in Denmark is the most expensive in the entire European Union. And I asked the CEO, and I said, well, can you please tell me why the hell you went to Denmark where you have to pay most for your electricity? And then he said, yes, but it is clean electricity from renewable energy sources. That's very important for our customers. And we have the impression that Denmark is the most digital-friendly country that we could find for such an investment. So the reasons why companies are making investments in that or that country are never one way, and they are multi-layered. They have different aspects, and we will see a competition for that. I'm interested, and we will study possible threats and possible opportunities at the time, but I'm not worried about that because it is something that we will clarify step by step, and therefore my conviction is that the financial institutions in London and all these companies will try to wait until they see whether the banking passport can be maintained. This is one is a very important element for them. But when they want to maintain the banking passport, it is very difficult to consider how some European countries would be ready to compromise on the migration issue. So this is we are just at the beginning of a very lengthy process. And one point that I would like to confirm what you have said is the question, yes, many, many countries in Europe, including some people in my own country, want to escape the supervision by the European Court of Justice. The judgments in many cases are considered as making things more difficult, as being nasty, as limiting national margin of maneuver. But we have seen over the last 20 years many countries outside the European Union, like Norway, like Switzerland, like Iceland, like others, they have, without any obligation by treaties, they have decided to implement 80%, 90% of the acquis communautaire into their domestic legislation. The Swiss have invented a term for that, a word for that, légiférer. I don't know how it sounds and what it means in England, but it means that every directive and regulation that has been tabled with regard to the internal market in Brussels and adopted by Parliament and Council will be transposed into Swiss national law because they consider it important to have the acquis communautaire of the internal market applicable in Switzerland even without the authority of the Court of Justice. And this is what Theresa May has said in the Tory party conference recently. She has said, well, we will escape from the authority of the in the jurisdiction of the Court of Justice. But at the same time, at the end of the negotiations under Article 50, Parliament will adopt legislation incorporating the existing acquis communautaire into British legislation. And then it will be a British law. It will be controlled and applied by British courts and not by the European Court of Justice. But if we would do something like this in Germany, I can tell you, I'm not commenting on the decisions of my British friends. I think it is very important to respect their sovereignty and their margin of debate and decision. But in Germany, if I would come to the conclusion, like Switzerland, that it would be better for us being outside the European Union to have the European laws incorporated in our national law, I would be worried, of course, if the German Constitutional Court and the German Civil Court and the Supreme Court and all the courts would then develop a jurisprudence not in parallel to the jurisprudence of the Court of Justice, because this would create other obstacles and other difficulties for our access to that internal market. So these are points that have to be clarified, and what we all need, and the media controlling our decisions and writing about our decisions in the governments, we simply need expertise. We simply need expertise, and this is something that we have to learn all together. I remember when I served as a EU Commission civil servant, we had to negotiate the European Economic Area for all the EFTA countries in 1991, in order to prepare some of them for accession to the European Union and to allow others to stay outside the European Union. And this was a very, very complicated, challenging exercise, because we had to check the entire acquis communautaire and then to decide what will be implemented by them, what will be accepted as an exemption from the acquis, and then these countries in the EEA, they are not subject to the legislation of the European Court of Justice, but they have their own EEA Court of Justice, EFTA Court of Justice, supervising in close cooperation with the European Court of Justice the implementation and application of EU law by the countries being member of the European Economic Area.
Thank you. We are inevitably moving away from the economics into the politics and the negotiation of Brexit. Daniela, let me put that question to you. How tough are the two sides going into these negotiations, which haven't yet started? And as the video says, we've still got until the end of March before Mrs. May has said that she will pull the trigger. But we've already seen plenty of posturing on both sides. So how difficult do you think it will be?
Definitely a lot of posturing. And it will be very difficult, because there are two conflicting interests on the side of the EU. One is obviously not to create a precedent. And that's not only a precedent for a country leaving the EU on good terms. So, you know, copycat effects in other countries, which may also consider holding a referendum and going down that same lane. But also a half-in, half-out deal with the UK would create new dynamics within the European Union, because actually the way the United Kingdom before the referendum negotiated its deal, which was a deal to actually be able to remain, which was the hope of then Prime Minister David Cameron, was also observed very closely by those countries in the European Union who do like the idea of weakening Brussels just a bit. And we talked about the ECJ there. You know, European institutions are not seen in the same way from all capitals. So there are lots of countries who would wish for a looser European Union without having to leave it. So in those two regards, a deal with the UK, which doesn't look nice to have, would be something that makes sense from the EU and a particular Brussels perspective. But then on the other hand, if we look at the strategic context that Europe is in, if we just pick up again the issue of the US elections and the questions we have vis-a-vis one of our main strategic allies, the United States. I think if we look at that dimension, if we look at the globally changed security environment, new challenges arising by the day and the extent of uncertainty that we are facing in this world out there, if we look at it from that perspective, of course, a very constructive and close relationship with the UK post-Brexit become something we are thriving for. This applies in defense and security terms, but to some extent, as we've discussed earlier, it also applies in economic terms, because the objective is to limit the negative effects on both sides.
Monique, if I could ask you, in effect, the same question. How do you see, and how does the Dutch government see, the two sides lining up against each other? Are you afraid of tough negotiations, or do you actually want the negotiations to be tough for the reasons that Daniela has sketched out?
Well, I would approach it from another side, I think. I think what is important to us is that there becomes clarity about what the UK wants, no negotiation without notification, that we hold up the four freedoms that we have in the internal market. I think those are the red lines that we have and that we have all agreed upon with the 27 other countries. Of course, the Brexit came in the Netherlands as a shock. It was something that we hadn't expected, that we hoped that would never happen, because we have excellent and important ties with the UK. And it will have a profound effect not only on us, but also on other member states, also in the political sense. With the Brexit, the EU will lose also a part of its footprint, you might say. Yeah? So I have some figures here. It will lose about 30% of its fleet. It will lose about 20% of its trading power. We talked about that already. 30% of its military capacities and about 16% of its GDP and 20% of its ODA. So it's an important step that the UK has decided to take. And I think for us it's very important that we continue with what is called the Bratislava process, the 27 countries that try to find a new way of dealing not only with a Brexit, but also a positive agenda. It's also about establishing new activities within the EU, a new way of working together, and making sure that we have, in the end, after all the negotiations that are still unclear when they're going to happen, but we hope they're going to happen soon, and in the end we would have preferably a result that is good for the Netherlands, that is good for Europe, and that's good for the UK as well.
The Netherlands, I'm just, if I may follow on, yeah, also has a its own domestic political debate. You have quite a strong populist party on the right, which has its own agenda, and there are even calls for leaving the European Union, even within the Netherlands. And there are also issues to do with migration control in the Netherlands. So what should the government, how should the government, or put another way, how does that consideration influence what the government says and does about Brexit? Does it want to be very tough against Britain and very EU-minded, solidarity-minded? Or does it say, hold on a minute, there are some issues that the British have raised which we are also facing here in the Netherlands, such as the migration question?
Yes, you're right. We have a large number of parties in the Netherlands. In fact, at the moment in Parliament, we have about 17 parties, which shows already that there are parties on all sides of the spectrum, you might say, including a more populist party, but it's not the only one. But if you look at the question whether or not the Netherlands would like to remain within the European Union, the answer is yes, there will be no Nexit. Mm-hmm. And even this party that might have some feelings for, or has a lot of criticism about the EU, in general, the Netherlands is pretty, I would not say Eurosceptic, but Eurocritical. Yeah? Mm-hmm. We feel that the European Union could improve in some ways, and that not everything has to be done on a European level, but that many things can be done on a member state level. So you have to pick your subjects. But generally speaking, there is a large majority of supporters for the EU. Also, the latest surveys have showed, including the one from the Bertelsmann Stiftung, that even the support for the EU has increased since the Brexit in the Netherlands. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't worry about any Nexits or things like that. Right. We will remain in the EU. It's our biggest a most important thing, mm-hmm. but we hope that we will reach in the end a kind of amicable solution with the UK, and a solution that is good for the Netherlands, good for Europe, and good for the UK as well.
Mm-hmm. Martin, I appreciate you're not speaking for the government, but you do follow what's going on in London very closely. What do you think? How much appetite is there still in Britain for what's often described as a soft Brexit? In other words, a Norway-style agreement or a Swiss-style? Or do you think, as many news reports are now suggesting, that Britain is moving towards a hard Brexit, which is a complete break with the European Union, a negotiated one, but a departure nonetheless, and some sort of arm's-length relationship with the European Union?
Well, this relates in part to what the options are, and this has been discussed very interestingly by the other members of the panel as they see it. And I understand fully, since, unlike me, you in particular have a position of responsibility, discussing hypothetical responses to hypothetical events is not what you should do. But it's, of course, precisely what I should do, because that's, otherwise I have no value added. I think that... So the first point, and I'd like to clarify a little bit about this ECJ issue, because in a second I'll come to that. I feel that I know a bit more about the economics than about the politics, because I'm not called chief political commentator, and probably because my colleagues would consider me completely incompetent in that regard. But I will venture into...
I don't think that's true at all.
I will venture into amateur political analysis, but I would emphasize amateur. So I believe, and I will explain that, despite the difficulties with the High Court, to which some elements of our media have responded in a truly disgraceful way, and to describe the behavior of some of our media disgraceful implies that they're behaving not merely below the standards of the FT, but even below theirs, which is saying something, given our media. But despite the activities of the High Court, which I expect will be supported by the Supreme Court, I think it's likely, I don't believe this will create a major difficulty for the Prime Minister, that she will be able to get parliamentary ratification, if she needs it, for a decision to negotiate. And there are two reasons for this. The first is that though it's certainly true that if we had a secret vote in Parliament, there will be a very large majority against Brexit. There's no doubt. But we won't have a secret vote in Parliament. And British politicians, above all the politicians in the Conservative Party, which is the only functioning party left in Britain, remember, we have no opposition party anymore. A sad situation, unique in my lifetime, but nonetheless the reality. So even worse than it was in the early 80s, and that's saying something. So we have the Conservative Party as the relevant party. True, it has a very small majority. But I think the Conservatives know, one, if they split on this matter, their party is in terrible trouble. Two, if the Conservative Party as a party has shown anything, I think it's probably the longest surviving major party in the world, certainly that I'm familiar with. It's been a functioning party for 160 years or so, 170 years, more than that. So it's a, and they keep together. And third, they consider the Brexit referendum outcome, which their government initiated and which was part of their manifesto, a pretty binding commitment. So if the leader of the party, whom they have chosen without opposition in the end, asks them to give this vote, I believe the Conservatives will give it to them without much difficulty. And they will therefore be able to carry it. Furthermore, I also believe, though this is slightly more heroic, that the House of Lords will accept this. The House of Lords is a peculiar anomaly. Almost everything in Britain is slightly peculiar. But in this case, there is a sort of binding convention, which I think is called the Salisbury Convention, which says that if something is done in pursuance of a manifesto commitment, the House of Lords does not overrule it. The Brexit was not a manifesto commitment, but was the referendum was. And the referendum was clearly about leaving. So for the House of Lords to try to delay this, and they can only delay it, would be very extraordinary and would create a monstrous constitutional crisis. And though anything is possible in politics these days, as we can see, I don't think that will happen. So the Prime Minister will be able to initiate this. The only interesting question then, and this is the last one, is whether in the process of initiating it in the parliamentary debate, she will actually have to tell somebody something about what she wants to do. Now, if we know anything about Theresa May, it's she doesn't like doing that. She has a very strong view, which she has shown very clearly in a not unsuccessful ministerial career, that sharing information with people is very dangerous for your political health. She makes Hillary Clinton look completely open and transparent in her dealings. She will do everything in her power not to reveal the details of her negotiating hand before it starts, because she doesn't want to get into the position of being publicly failing to achieve what she wants. So she will try to reach a position with as soon after this as she can. She will clearly try to reach a position in which she only asks what she can get, which is also, by the way, what David Cameron tried. And then you have to go back to what I think are her binding constraints. Her binding constraints are, politically, that her party will fragment, I think, under her because of the Brexiter side, if she doesn't come back with control on immigration, and if she doesn't pretty clearly establish the primacy of British law. And this is just the last point I wanted to make on how that will be interpreted. My interpretation of the Prime Minister's statement about EU law is that she knows, which is obviously true, that EU law is currently governing Britain. Of course it is. We've been in the EU since 1973. Of course it does. We don't want to create a legal anarchy in Britain. So all the existing EU law, which is the law of the land, effectively, will become part of our law to be interpreted by our courts and to be subsequently moderated and modified as it will be in the normal legislative process. This is, of course, a very different commitment from being in a situation in which we have to incorporate future EU law directly or indirectly, and abide by interpretations of future EU law, be it through the EFTA Court or the ECJ, which ultimately emanate from the EU. I believe that will be extremely politically difficult, as in potentially suicidal, for her to accept. If you accept those two constraints are binding, as I think she sees them as things are now, the logic is we cannot stay in the single market. Seems to me quite clear. The passporting is gone, whether they like it or not. I've suggested in my column for tomorrow that we might be able to do some sort of straight trade deal. I think the most sensible transition deal on trade is simply to suggest we stay for a transition period in the customs union, which is a fairly straightforward thing. But I think we have to, if that's, I think, the reality. Whether she will say that or how she will say that at the beginning of this negotiation, I have absolutely no idea.
Peter, if I can turn to you. What are Germany's red lines? I know you don't want to pre-negotiate or let alone negotiate, but people, ministers have spoken publicly about the principles that Germany is standing for in this context. So could you tell us what those red lines are, and in particular, whether in this contentious area of migration, there is any possibility of flexibility and agreement with Great Britain?
Please forgive me, but we have just moved to the political implications of Brexit, and please allow me to say a few words about that. I believe the political implications are extremely important, but perhaps easier to handle than the economic implications. Political implications, when we look back at the last 120, 30 years of European history, the big tragedy of the First World War has to be seen in the context of a non-existing cooperation between Germany, Austria on the one hand, and France and the UK on the other hand. I remember Otto von Bismarck, who had established very, very tight informal relationship with his counterparts in London. And we have, he has been supported by them when he has made the German Empire in 1871. But then when he tried to formalize it, it seemed to be very difficult. And then the British colleagues said, well, no, we are not yet ready for that. And then when the new, the young emperor, Guillaume II, was trying to have a navy for Germany, then in 1900, in 1901, the Brits made an offer to Chancellor von Bülow in Berlin to have a formalized cooperation, and then Bülow was not in a position to accept that because Bülow had promised to the emperor to realize the navy. And this was, of course, unacceptable for the United Kingdom in that time, because as a British Prime Minister, and also Lord Grey, the former, the later Foreign Secretary, has put it, Germany has an army and Britain has a navy. That was the compromise and the way of coexistence between the two of them. And I have always felt that the lack of a European idea and the lack of a cooperation between the three big countries, economically and militarily, big and important countries, has been to the has contributed enormously to all the misery of the early 20th century. So I consider it as extremely important that whatever the economic relationship might be, we should try to work closely together in all the security issues, counterterrorism, protection against other countries with unlawful ideas and intentions. We have to think about what we can do, by the way, also to have the UK as a partner in the discussion about the big political issues that we are deciding in the EU. They will be outside the EU, but this is a dialogue we need. And therefore, we have to think about the framework for that. The issue of the of immigration, however, is an issue, and Monique has mentioned that, that is closely linked to the internal market. The internal market is not three fundamental freedoms plus immigration outside it. The internal market consists of four fundamental freedoms, including immigration, not of everybody from a worldwide scale, but from inside the European Union for EU citizens. And this is a tragic irony of history, because I remember my debates with my Tory colleagues. We had a when the Tory party was still a member of the EPP in Brussels, in the European Parliament, we had a circle in Cadenabia, where ministers, secretaries, state secretaries, members of parliament met once a year over a weekend to discuss European politics and our bilateral relationship. I remember how proud my Tory colleagues have been when the UK has been the only country in Europe not imposing transitional periods for freedom of movement to the 10 new member countries from Eastern and Central Europe. And the argument that the Polish plumber is a big, big relief for every citizen in the UK and that they have now better quality of service, etc., was told to me at least 10 times a week. When I met with British friends. So now we have the transitional periods have expired. Germany has enormously benefited from Polish plumbers in the meantime because more than 50% of all the renovation in Berlin homes and flats over the last 10 years have been affected by Polish plumbers, electricians, and other craftsmen with enormous skills and low prices. This is something that has made the Polish in Germany more popular. However, in the United Kingdom, and I've never understood it, it seems to me that people are not afraid of somebody coming, coming in the course of the refugee issue, or coming from former Commonwealth countries, but the Polish plumber is the one where so many people say, well, this is something that escaped our control, and this is something we have to find a solution for. And this is very difficult for the EU to digest and to accept, because we have never accepted it before. And the four fundamental freedoms are the four fundamental freedoms because they cover all of the economic activities. But it has also been an historic compromise, because the fact that Italy, Spain, Portugal, Poland had to open their markets for German cars and other goods manufactured in Germany and British services meant that they would have an opportunity for their people to go to Germany, to France, to Spain, to the UK in order to be employed or to be a self-employed person. So this is one of the biggest economic issues. It has political implications, I admit, but it has to be negotiated and not, of course, decided tonight. The political cooperation is perhaps much more than just being member countries of NATO. I regret very much, in case there are some people from our Foreign Office present. When I was elected Member of Parliament in 1994, there has been a Königswinter Conference. And the Königswinter Conference took place once a year. It was called after Königswinter, as you can imagine. 1 year in Königswinter, 1 year in Oxford or in Cambridge. Then we had about 250, 300 outstanding business people, politicians, trade unionists, journalists, professors, academic people, discussing and debating all these issues across party lines. That was a wonderful experience and has contributed a lot. And over the years, apparently both the Foreign Office in the UK and the Foreign Office in Germany have reduced the money that was available for the conference. First, they have reduced the number of days, then they have reduced the number of participants. I have nothing heard, never received an invitation for many, many years now. And then I thought it was dissolved. And then I was told by the German chairman of Königswinter, no, it still exists. But as long as this is not generally known, by the acting politicians, it is not that effective as it could be. We have to think about fora, and not just between Germany and the UK, between Europe and the UK, where we have no obligations to behave in this or that way, but where we can have an exchange of views that would benefit all of us. And the last point, what I consider as a pity, is that for so many years, my British colleagues were complaining in informal circles about the very close Franco-German relationship. And I always replied, that is something you have to understand. We are neighbors in Europe, and the fact that we have overcome our conflicts has helped us to build Europe. But over the last 10 years at least, things have not changed as far as German-Franco relationship is concerned. But for example, after the last European Parliament election, there was a boat trip organized by Mr. Reinfeldt in Sweden, and the participants were David Cameron, Mark Rutte, Mr. Reinfeldt, and Angela Merkel. And they have drafted a paper, and this paper has almost literally be transposed into the guidelines of the European Council for the European Commission as a working program for the next 4 years. The political weight and the political influence of the United Kingdom has been never as big as they have been over the last 4 or 5 years. And this is something that is, unfortunately, that has not been understood by my political colleagues, not dealing with European and foreign affairs. We had a complete silence between the two camps in the UK. And therefore, for Germany, I draw a conclusion. And my conclusion is that we have to give a higher priority to issues of European cooperation, of foreign and security policy on the political agenda, because the sake of our country, as I see it, largely depends on our integration in European and international structures, and therefore our MPs have to understand the enormous importance of this in modern times, and therefore we have to reward politicians who are ready to serve in the Foreign Affairs Committee, European Affairs Committee, etc., to make it more attractive to deal with this international affairs.
And just to follow up that point, about the importance of security, do you think the election of Donald Trump in the United States makes it more necessary that there is security and defence cooperation within Europe?
I'm now speaking as a private person, if that is possible. I don't know.
Of course.
No. Whenever I tried it, yes, it went wrong in the past. What I can describe as a private person is the fact that perhaps not the result of the American elections, but also the way of the campaign, the presidential campaign, has concerned and deeply worried many people in Europe. And this is something where we don't know yet the consequences of it for the domestic political debate in the US. We have not yet a clear picture political priorities of the new administration. But what I would defend now, very cautiously and reluctantly and without making any predictions, but my impression is that the new president has made no announcements that would make it impossible for him to respect some continuity in foreign and security matters. He has talked about his view on the Middle East conflict, and basically he has told us he wants to resolve that. He has not announced that he would leave NATO or other things. He will denounce probably a free trade arrangement with the Asian community. All this has to be carefully studied. We as Europeans, we have a genuine interest in preserving the transatlantic alliance. And the US are a democracy, a vital democracy, by the way, with a slightly different political culture. But the election of Donald Trump has to be compared also to the election of Barack Obama 8 years ago. There are many, many countries in Europe where the election of a child of an immigrant would not be possible today. It was possible in the US, and Mr. Barack was re-elected. Mr. Obama was re-elected, and now it was possible for the Americans to elect Mr. Trump. That is their understanding of democracy, and democracy has to be respected. What the Chancellor has told the incoming president is that, of course, our cooperation is based on values and common values that we have established in the West. The West is not a geographical term. It's a term of values. And this is, democracy has been invented in the US, it has been invented in the United Kingdom, it has been invented in France. Would be glad if it would have been invented in Germany as well, but I wouldn't go that far. We have been a little bit late as a country, as a nation, and also a little bit late in this. I cannot advise somebody in Europe, and it's not my responsibility. But I believe that we should all Europeans be committed to this transatlantic cooperation. When I look at my country, I have the impression that anti-American resentments have grown over the last 20, 30 years. In the beginning, it was something with regard to the Vietnam War, and then later on to the Iraq War. Now it has been extended by so many people to other issues like TTIP. I still consider TTIP as very important, and I would like to see a revival of European-American relationship, and would be very happy if the UK would play a very constructive role in that.
Daniela, on the point of Mr. Trump, and coming back to our main theme, which is Brexit, to what extent do you think his election and the political impact it is having and will have in future will affect the Brexit talks? Do you think it opens up all sorts of questions which weren't open before, or perhaps do you think that it might focus the minds a bit on solving this problem, the Brexit issue, in a more reasonable way, because there are now so many other unknown questions that may have been opened?
Well, I've given part of the answer in my earlier take, because I do believe that looking at the Brexit issue from a European, being a British and a continental European perspective, now in the changed, possibly changed strategic context with the US maybe redefining their engagement in world affairs, both economically and in security and foreign policy terms, it does change the strategic considerations that we should have on both sides. But there's something interesting, obviously, that happened very, very soon after the election of Donald Trump, and that is a new conversation which kind of created possibly an illusion of a relaunch of the special relationship the UK out of the European Union might have with the United States. A lot of talk has been going on in a specific trade deal, now that TTIP has been declared dead, that the UK could possibly negotiate a very preferential agreement with the United States. I don't think that this will happen. I just don't believe that the US are interested. If they look at the economics of their trade relationship with Europe, that they single out the United Kingdom as a privileged partner. I also don't believe that the United States have a true interest in unraveling the economic relationship with Europe. So I think from a UK perspective, the conditions of negotiating Brexit haven't really improved.
Monique, you've heard this, the question about security and defence. The Netherlands is a medium-sized member of the European Union and of NATO. Are you worried that you will become an less secure place, either because of Brexit or because of Mr. Trump or because of both?
Well, I think what all these developments show is something that has been going on for quite a while now, and not just because of Trump, but it has been going on for a couple of years. And that's the whole discussion of how the EU and the EU member states should get their defense act together, if you wish. So I think that's an important question. It also may, because of all these developments, it may speed up this process. I think it's very important that we do that in the security field. It's also important that we realize that we can't go at it alone. We need NATO in this sense. So it's not just EU or NATO or the common foreign policy within the EU, but it's a combination of things. And what we also feel is very important is that within the European group of countries, we might need some leadership, some guidance, and in this sense, Germany is for us a very important partner.
Is Germany ready to offer that leadership and guidance?
Sometimes you seem to believe I'm even more naive than I look. No, it is not. I'm deeply convinced that we are not talking about leadership by countries. Of course, the United Kingdom, France, Germany, and even much more the U.S. have a political weight because they have large economies, they have a military, they have an impact. But leadership today is more than ever before a matter of personal leadership by heads of states and governments. This is something that we have to realize. It is not automatically the case that a German chancellor would be recognized by others as a partner and invited for exchange. It is not an automatic thing that even an American president is with all the superpower means he has is leading the world. It depends on the circumstances, on the constellations, and this is exactly what we are trying to do. And we have adopted one philosophy after this terrific Second World War and Nazi dictatorship, that we wanted to be on the European and international scene, always never part of the problem, but if possible, always part of the solution. And this has benefited the German national interest to the same extent as it has benefited the European and the national interest. We are now and today, I have now seen some estimations about the German export and of services and goods and for this year. And it's not shrinking. Huh? It is our economy is doing quite well, and I believe that this is due, of course, due to the quality of our goods and manufacturing skills, but it is also due to the image of the country that exists. And therefore, we will try to be helpful as good as we can, but we know that we are not a world power, we are not a superpower, and we can never be that, we will never be that, and therefore we want Europe to be as strong as possible. And this is why the Chancellor has had a very good relationship with Mark Rutte, and she still has with David Cameron until the referendum took place. We are struggling to... Now he is no longer a prime minister. I mean, that's not that personal relationship has been damaged, but he's no longer a prime minister. What certainly will be a chance for Europe to unite is the fact that next year we will have, for the first time in perhaps one decade, the French presidential election and the German parliament election within a distance of a couple of months. And that means that by the end of 2017, we will have a German and a French government with a 4 years perspective of doing politics, and this will help us to cooperate with our European partners and will perhaps also offer an opportunity when we are talking about security and political issues for a better cooperation with the UK.
Martin, if I can turn to you, and you've said you're willing to answer hypothetical questions, so here's one. If things go badly, the negotiations are difficult and it ends in tears, who benefits? Is this a plus for Russia? Is this a plus for China, the US, anyone at all, or does everybody lose?
Now, that's an interesting question. Let me just make, if I may, because some of the points here have been very big and very important, and then I'll come to this one. I found myself in this referendum, in writing columns, which I did a great many, on this issue. I found myself in a very interesting position because I have been over 25 years, I've been around a long time, very critical of a great many decisions the European Union has made. In particular, I remain of the view that the creation of the single currency was an error, as it was done. I took this position when I started at the FT, which was in 1987, time of the Delors Committee. And I didn't think the Eurozone crisis was brilliantly handled, if I may suggest it. And yet, I felt that the position the British had got themselves into, and you've described beautifully doesn't even begin to get close to the reality of the extraordinary, devastating incompetence with which the issue of immigration has been handled, both in practice and at a rhetorical level in the UK. And incompetence is quite a kind word. That's how I view British policy, but I've found myself very passionately engaged in this debate. And I wrote a great many pieces on the lines that this was a completely crazy thing to decide, as it will prove to be. But at the end, I wanted to make clear something absolutely fundamental. I believe very passionately, this is where it gets personal. I'm the child, as probably most people knows anything about, of Europe, refugees from Europe. My father came from Vienna, my mother came from the Netherlands, and I don't think it takes any tremendous imagination to work out who I am. And I am a passionately committed European because I believe in European civilization at its best, since my parents and their families experienced it at its worst. I appreciate it very much at its best. And I believe very passionately in what Angela Merkel described as European values, which are Western values, the ones we share. To me, it is quite simply a tragedy of the first order. For me personally, and me as a political person and as a citizen of my country where I was born, that the United Kingdom should have decided, as it were, again, to put itself outside Europe. I think that is a tremendous strategic mistake by the UK, but also a civilizational mistake, a profound civilizational mistake. And because it will weaken the West, and I don't think there's any doubt, it will weaken the West, and just as the possible split which might now emerge between the US and Europe will do so, because I think we have to stick together, not because as a power system, but because we embody a set of values about the way people should live their lives together, economically and politically, and as human beings, which, despite all the tragedies, to me is sort of the best human beings have done. So I think this is a catastrophe, what's happening, and it has weakened us immensely. Now, the only point I would make is, at the end of all this, because we've made a terrible mistake, and it will weaken Europe. Britain is one of the great European nations. As I pointed out, it has always been a European country. It couldn't be anything else but a European country. Just think who's lived in Britain and the contributions Britain has made to Europe. And the same, of course, it's unthinkable without Europe. So this separation is a tragedy. What we have to find is a way of making the economic relationship. I know I'm not really answering your question, but I'm answering the question I feel you should have asked. I believe separation economically is underway, and it will be very costly. We do have to find a way, and I think this is desperately important for Britain, but I think it's also desperately important for Europe, to bind the West as a system of ideas and values, but also a geopolitical structure together. And I do think it is incredibly important at the end of this next 2 years of mess and anger and frustration that we have found a way to do this that doesn't cause a permanent wedge. And I am very fearful that that is what is going to happen. So I'd just like to say at the end of all this, this was personal, it really matters. We can live with the economic damage. It'll be annoying, but we can live with it. If we're separated in a more profound way than that, it's a tragedy we'll all feel.